Hello there. You're very welcome along to episode 33 of the Football Pod with Paddy Andrews and James O'Donoghue. Boys, we've been recording these last few episodes early in the morning. We're in the midst of a heat wave. Paddy Andrews, you were up this morning bright and early, gone for a run. Is that right?
I was. Yeah, I was. Phoenix Park, the sun was shining. I was awake early, got down there. The sun was rising at the far end of the park. A little bit of mist coming up. The deer's having their brekkie. Ah, it's beautiful down there.
He's an early riser, Jim. The WhatsApp has been giving it away the last couple of weeks.
4:58 he texts into the group the last day, yeah. I haven't seen 4:58. 42 years.
What's going on, Lack?
I told you, if I'm on the WhatsApp at that time, I've either been on the absolute piss or the little cat is acting the maggot. Kick him out of the gas. It was the cat this week. I wasn't on the beer at 4:58 on Tuesday morning, now, I have to say.
And you're both dressed for the beast today, and I'm the only man here going to work.
I've a couple of days off at the minute, but I am not built for the sun, lads. I was in Bannistrand last week and I got scalded. Absolutely scalded. Like a tomato coming home.
Was it busy there?
Yeah, packed. But it's some set up. A couple of little food trucks, side of the beach. You know,
nice beach.
It was lovely. Yeah, really nice. Nice wee walk there as well. So,
you can't go wrong in Kerry.
Why would you leave Kerry if you were reared in Kerry? That's what I realised driving through it the last day. Mm. Why would you leave Kerry? Do you know, I had a chat with Shane Walsh and Sean O'Shea about 10 days ago up in Dublin and Vincent's, and it just struck me that none of the Kerry boys are in Dublin. There's no one based up there, is there?
No. There's actually not one player, I'd say. Maybe college or something. Some fella might be caught up there, but you wouldn't move up there until probably you're finished, yeah.
Even college, I mean, none of the Kerry lads were DCU or UCD or anything. Was that UCC? But there would have been a few. And then
Jack Barry went to UCD.
Was he?
Jack was there.
Yeah, he played tickets with them.
Did he? All right. Yeah. What's the best beach in Kerry, Jimmy? From the horse's mouth. I have my own favourite.
There's a good few, not to be fair, but I like Castle Gregory.
Right.
And Rossbay.
Oh, Rossbay, yeah.
Rossbay is strong. I've never been to Castle Gregory.
And Darren Sullivan has his little restaurant.
Yeah. Nothing for Inch Beach, no.
Inch is nice, but you drive the car onto Inch, it kind of takes a bit away from the scene, do you know what I mean? You're lying out getting your tan on, and the next thing a car just absolutely tears over the back of your head.
Usually a dub as well, probably, is it?
What's your favourite
beach? All the dubs don't. They don't know how to treat the place properly.
What's your favourite beach, Paddy?
What?
What's your favourite beach in Kerry? Inch, is it?
Inch, yeah. I'd be a big fan of Inch. That'd be me, doing wheelies through
it. Don't it? You'd be stuck in the sand, then it would be pushing you out of it.
I swear to God, we were out on the beach. The tide has been late all week in Dublin, so we were down on Wednesday night out the Dolly Mount, so out in Clontarflick. Late night swim would be grand. I'd be known around here about 9:30, and the place was fucking rammed, like traffic jam in and out of Clontarflick. Every night this week in Dublin. Portmarnock, Malahide, Sea Point, Clontarf, everywhere has been absolutely packed. Getting now looking for an old quiet swim, like you're saying, Jimmy. And you get out there and it's like a match day out around there. So
it's nice to have it. The big thing is though, club training, I think, has been pushed back to about 8:30 some evenings, just to get that bit cooler, you know?
Yeah, yeah. It'd be hard going playing in this 27, 28 degrees. We're not built for it, lads.
Water breaks are brought back.
Water breaks.
Were they? Where? In Clare?
Tactics boards all over the country. Mayo, Kerry, everywhere. All over the country.
They brought back in Kerry?
Yeah, brought back this weekend in Kerry. All over the country.
We have to bring back the Maor Uisce, who just comes onto the field and is the 16th player for about 5 minutes. Intercepting kickouts, handing out water bottles.
Yous were an absolute disgrace for that.
No.
Tommy Griffin.
Sherlock played corner forward in 2015.
You started it. Tuck would be taking a kick out, and Griffin would be standing there in wing back position, pretending to be talking to someone.
We had a slot for him.
Man off the pitch. He was a disgrace. You started that, and then we started playing J.O. centre forward, yeah.
In the hurling game, one of the Maor Uisce tackled a fella one time. That was the last straw, wasn't it?
When you start getting interceptions, it's a bit much.
We'll get the thoughts of our special guest this week, lads. Andy Moran, former presenter of the Football Pod and current Leitrim manager, is going to join us for a chat this week. A great reaction last week to our chat with Paddy Talley. So Andy has a lot to live up to here. We'll get his thoughts on Maor Uisce as well as much more. Anything to add, Paddy, before we bring him in? Anything you want to say about this man before we bring him into the pod?
He was away himself last week, by all accounts. Looked very nice down in Portugal.
Family holiday.
Now, do you know what? I'm intrigued to hear from his team. We're obviously heavily involved in the Talton Cup, and we've touched on it kind of looking in from the outside. We feel it was a success, you know, in terms of the games, in terms of the coverage it got. His team were beaten on penalties. Mm. We're huge penalty shootout fans here. It's interesting to see what someone who was involved in one and who were beaten in one, his thoughts on it as well. But just, I think it's been a successful first year for him in the job. What does he think? And what do the Leitrim players think? And what are his plans for next season? But no, it's great to have him back. We're kind of chatting in and out throughout the year on WhatsApp and things like that. So
yeah,
good to catch up with him.
James, did you come across Andy Moran off the pitch or on the pitch when you were playing much?
On the pitch, obviously. Mm. But never off.
Really? Never off the pitch? No.
Never off. Okay. I'd say face to face, I've probably spoken to Andy once, maybe.
Okay.
So,
all right.
A legend, and
he's an awful baller.
My girlfriend has a thing for Andy. Like, it's actually awkward.
Oh yeah.
What?
God, yeah. She goes, oh, Andy's on the show this week. Oh, Andy. I was like, all right, relax.
Well, hey, everyone loves Andy Moran. That's the thing.
He is a legend, to be fair to him.
let's get to it now. You're listening to episode 33 of the Football Pod. If you haven't subscribed yet, please do. We'll have plenty for you over the next couple of months. We're back right after this, talking to the legend that is Andy Moran. You're very welcome back to the Football Pod here with Paddy Andrews, James O'Donoghue, and Andy Moran. Andy, welcome back to the pod.
It's great to be back. I'm nervous, lads. I'm nervous. I won't lie to you.
Don't be getting any ideas now. You left and that's it. I'm staying.
Jamesy, to be honest with you, I was kind of half hoping that you'd be a bit shit, like, but you've been deadly. But like I was coming in there this morning, met Mickey Conroy. Mickey lives here in Castlebar, Mickey ex-Mayo. And he was walking his young fella around and he just goes, listening to Paddy Talley here. The boys are brilliant on the pod. So listen, that was a promotion at 7:30 this morning. So you're doing well.
But
no, it's been brilliant, lads. Listening to us. Didn't listen to it much during the season when we were playing, but listened to it all through. And I thought I tweeted about it at the time. I thought the semi-final pod, lads, was incredible. You know, it was just, you had plenty to choose from, to be fair. But I was just thinking about it this morning, coming home over in the car. The little detail that you gave that day about the Murphy pass. Like, I don't think the normal Joe Soap kind of can notice that pass was so important. I think there's two guys that hit that pass, a really naive young guy, a really experienced player that knows, listen, I need to get the ball to Clifford here. He's showing for it. Let me kick it. And the confidence to kick that. Fenton's pass to Small just before where they get the thing. And I don't think the normal Joe notices that. And I think the quality you've given over the... Remember you were on about McCaig. He marked Comer. He didn't mark Comer. He stayed on Finnerty. Even that little detail. I thought that was just magic. And then there was a time when we were in it, James. And Paddy, you described Kevin Mack's goal against Dublin in 13. Remember that?
Yeah.
I could nearly feel I was there. I think the only game I missed this year in Croker was actually the semi-final between Dublin and Kerry. But the feeling that she gave, like, in terms of the atmosphere around that kick and everything for Sean O'Shea, I think it was brilliant. So I think that was the best pod that was ever done.
Slightly biased, but
I wasn't on it, Paddy. So I'm actually giving you credit. I'm giving you credit. So
you know what I'd say on the big thing about the Murphy kick, because you're right, we were looking at it, and it's easy to give a safe pass there, but even more, like, Murphy, he's an experienced player, but he wasn't in the team, like, you know, and we've all been there where you're a bit older and you're not as guaranteed your place and you might be coming off the bench. That adds even more pressure to it. So when you're coming off the bench, you go, I can't make a mistake here.
Yeah.
My place is on the line type thing. And you can play a safe pass. And that was an even more impressive thing. And he does one in the final as well to Sean O'Shea. I think it's...
Backdoor head pass.
Yeah. Gavin White ends up tapping it over the bar. So look, we've been fortunate enough to play in those type of games, in those situations. When you see something like that, you know it's not a normal moment in the game.
No.
Unbelievable, the highest of high pressure. And Murphy's pass there was luck. Yeah, it was probably a massive moment in swinging that game in Kerry's way. So you're right. Yeah, that the atmosphere from that day was incredible. But geez, Andy, try sitting beside a Kerry fella like as they beat you. Like it's
like I was laughing last week.
Diabolical stuff.
When he mentioned the hand pass to Tally, I was like, will you get over it, Jimmy? Will you?
We were robbed.
12 years later, giving out about Down beating them.
I never asked him why they lost to Monaghan as well with Galway in 18. They'd have been in the All Ireland final.
That's another one. That's the one that you put the Michael Meehan, isn't it?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Like they would have in the groups, if they lost to Monaghan, which they did, they'd have got Dublin in the semi. Whereas if they beat Monaghan, I forget who they'd have got. Oh, they'd have got Tyrone, wasn't it? Yeah.
They'd play Tyrone, yeah.
Yeah.
They was there for them, like.
That was it. That's
you left him off the hook with it.
That's the way it goes. Breaks. Andy, one of the trends, obviously.
Breaks.
Go on. What are the trends on the football pod? Unfortunately, like we're two seasons in now, is that in the off season, the co-hosts have been getting tapped up left, right, and centre from other counties. Last year, we were in the off season, James. It was very difficult. Transfer rumours were coming in every week. Andy Moran's linked to this job. Andy Moran's linked to this job. Yep. Such and such has reached out to Andy Moran. Andy, I don't know whether the lads' phones have been ringing from counties. There's about 8 counties still looking for coaches or managers over the last couple of months and weeks. Any advice for the two boys if somebody rings them? What are the first few things you'd say to them if you get approached by a county? I know Philly McMahon was approached in the last week or so, he said in his column.
Yeah, we'll come back to that. Like, but like, Paddy, you've left him off the hook all year. Like, did he not switch club? Like, and him on about us transfer windows. And this one, well, he's going from me to Clare. Like, you know,
he's like Frankie DeYoung there. Wait, I'm trying. It's bitter. Like.
I'm trying to extend my football career. I'm living down in Clare, lad. That's all I'm trying to do.
No, I think
Paddy Lane now extend the career.
Yeah, extend the career is right. But I think the big thing. In terms of what I've learned throughout the first year is to have really good people that you can talk to. If that's somebody you know, or if that's somebody you can get to know over the course of the conversations. Like last year, I was, I suppose, rang from one or two counties in terms of going in coaching and stuff. And I got to know other managers throughout that course of them conversations. And then it was really handy for me then to have them conversations throughout the year. What do you do in this situation? Where, Joe, how would you deal with this? And I think that was the biggest learning, because lads, you sit on the side of being a player and you think you know what's going on the management side. And until you go over to the dark side, lads, you haven't a clue. So it's been a huge learning curve, but the key to having, obviously I had John O there anyway, who I could talk to, but to have mentors that have operated around Division 3 and Division 4, I think was the key thing for me throughout the course of the first year.
Really? Would you have said you were like kind of in management mode in your last couple of years as a player? Like, did you kind of think that you had that kind of extra responsibility? Or because I know as a corner forward, sometimes you're so worried about your sharpness being right, your kicking being right. It's kind of a lot to be in your own head about. But did you kind of feel yourself being management style even then?
I think in 19, James, I probably went over too much to that. Like I went in, I looked at it as a bonus year anyway in terms of playing. I remember when James rang me, I said, yeah, listen, one more year, I'm out the gap here. And I really did observe what was going on. We had a guy in at the time, was James Burke, who played with us in 14. You know him, Paddy, from Bally.
Yeah.
He plays Ballymun. But he was in, he played with us, and then he came in coaching us. And I just loved the way he kind of interacted with the players. Like, I was the captain of the team when he was actually in the squad. And then a couple of years later, he's there. He's 5 years younger than me. He's coaching the team. But I loved the way he didn't feel he needed to come in and stampede on us and give his impression. He came in and did it really nicely, respected the kind of the group, but got his point across really well, observed James a lot. But there was one stage in it where Chris Barrett pulls me aside and he goes, Andy, what are you doing here? He said, you're competing against these guys. He goes, will you stop coaching them? He goes, we need you to actually fucking play here, you know? So there was a bit of a James, definitely, but it was kind of more of a coaching side, and the management side was kind of observing what James and the likes of James Burke and them guys were doing in 19.
Isn't that a key thing, Andy, you say, with James Burke coming in? Because we had the exact same thing with Brian Cullen, where he came in and it's, he has the respect, because you've played with this guy and you know him, he has the respect of the dressing room as it is.
So they don't need to force anything. You need to know your stuff. Obviously, you're being a coach and you're a trainer, but there's credibility straight. There's cash in the bank right from the get-go. And that's, he can kind of relax and be himself. And you don't need to force or try and reinvent the wheel. And that's, I think it's a big thing. And I'd say for you even going in, this is your first kind of inter-county job where you're going in and every one of those Leitrim lads is looking down. Well, Andy Moran's a legend. So it gives you, you still need to prove yourself and add value for the guys, but it gives you a little bit of a head start going in, because we were chatting with Paddy Talley even on this last week. A massive thing for a coach or a manager going into a dressing room for the first time is getting the players on side. And if you've had the playing background or you've played with the guys before, that gives you just that little bit of a head start and makes that transition a bit easier, I'd say.
Yeah, like the thing with the Leitrim stuff, Paddy, was different, where they went through COVID, and like we come from three really spoiled counties, really, in terms of the advantages of having finance available to us, whatever we need in terms of... whatever we need. Wait till I get into AIG and they should be giving some money to Leitrim. But we've everything we need, really, to get to the top for a game, and we have that. So I went into Leitrim. They've just gone through 2 years of COVID. Like, the difference in what was available to players in Division 4 compared to where we, our privileged existence in Division 1 was just insane, lads. And
give us an example.
Is that a shock to you?
It's 100%. It's the access. Lads, let's not dress this up. And people don't like to talk about it. It's nearly like an area you're not allowed to mention, but it's the access to finance in terms of money. Like, so if you're looking, going in last year, you have the greatest football team that probably ever played, Paddy's team in Dublin, who have, this is absolutely no disrespect to Dublin. I think I mentioned that plenty of times last year. You've got your house in order. You do stuff the right way. You've Costello in there that's running the kind of background stuff where you never have to worry about it. Everyone lives in Dublin. So if you take the expenses route that happened during the year, for instance. It's not. People must think these expenses come from central council or something. It's the county boards that pay these expenses. So if you're driving from Dublin, where we have half our team, to Leitrim, or you're playing for Dublin and you live in Dublin, you work in Dublin, the expense on the Leitrim County Board is greater than the expense on the Dublin County Board. And Leitrim probably finished around 32nd in 2021. And now in 2022, they're going into the same competition as a Dublin, who start as the greatest team of all time anyway. They start with, they don't have this outgoing of expense every month that a Leitrim would have. And then you have to go and try to compete with this. So it leaves it really, really tight. And Leitrim are very lucky to have a really good county board who keep the finances really tight and everything is done to an edge. But there has to be something that's given towards a Leitrim and Sligo and these guys if they want us to compete with the likes of a Kerry, Dublin, Mayo, etc. moving forward.
Do the players ever get pissed off with it? Like, do they know the kind of the difference? Like, do they ever say, do you know what, fuck this, I couldn't, do you know, this is not worth it? Do they get like that?
Yeah, we were, when the GPA thing was kind of going this year, when it was going, it was very interesting, the conversations, and in terms of where the money comes from and how it's paid and where it's paid. And we two very good reps in Shane Moran and Shane Quinn in terms of how they were explaining that to the players. And they were saying, right, lads, we mightn't have the access to hear where a Dublin are talking or a Mayo are talking or a Kerry are talking, you know. So they kind of explained it really well. There'll be a bit of pissed off. But the fellas that we started with, 36. We finished with 36 throughout the course of the championship. I think if they're playing and if they feel like they're improving, I think they're okay with it. The money, the expenses isn't the driver. But I do feel if you're from a smaller county, there is a stage where you'd probably go, hold on here for a second. Is this worth it? Am I losing too much money? If inflation stays at 10%, will they be able to afford it? I remember when we started, lads, I think diesel was about 83 cent a mile or something. And we used to get 50 cent a mile. Like, sure, we're making money.
You're older than us, lads.
I know. But we're making money. Yeah, it's literally, that expenses thing has gone down, but it has to come from central council. It can't be expected that a county board with lower gates that can pay a greater amount, even though the majority of Mayo, Dublin, Kerry players would live in their home county, do you know?
I think Paddy was about to ask you there, were you surprised when you went into Leitrim and you saw this? Do you get the sense that Anton, is this being spoken about, that Anton could be done about this at some stage soon?
Oh, I think 100%. It's yeah. I think the county board treasurers and chairmen are just saying, hold on, someone has to say stop. And they're basically saying to the GAA here, come on, we need a tiny bit of help here. You need to help us out a tiny bit more. And how that's done, I think, is going to be a big conversation throughout the course of the winter.
Okay. Andy, let's crunch some of the numbers here from your first year in intercounty management with Leitrim. So you started off in Division 4. Am I right in saying there was an FBD League game in January? That was your first match as a Leitrim boss.
Was it in the Dome?
Yeah. In early January. Yeah. So you had that game. There was no other games then until Division 4 kicked in.
Correct, yeah. The game in the Dome was brilliant. The problem with the FPD last year, we'd have loved if it was a round robin and we got three games, because just to see who we had. But we really good challenge matches throughout that course. I think we played Roscommon, we played Mayo, so we kind of filled it in. We filled it in along with that as well.
So you kicked into the year then, and you had a tough start. You had Cavan right away in Division 4, but right up until round 7 of the league, Leitrim are still in the mix. I think round 7 actually against Sligo, it ends up being a dead rubber because of the manner in which the games are fixed. I think Tip play London on the Saturday, and whatever way that result went, it kind of meant that Sligo London then was a dead rubber. You kick into the Connacht Championship then, so in Division 3 you had 4 wins, or Division 4 you had 4 wins and 3 losses, but you were right in the mix up until the end there. Kick into the Connacht Championship, you win your first game against London. You go up again against the eventual All-Ireland finalists, Galway, and you're beaten in, that game was in Salt Hill.
Mm.
And then you're into the Tailteann Cup. So a big win against Antrim, end of McGinley's Antrim. That was a big day in Carrick and Shannon. I was watching it and you could see the atmosphere and the fans spilling onto the pitch afterwards, and kind of the bit of vibe around Leitrim football that day was really evident. And then you went on to Sligo and you're beaten on penalties after extra time. But a fairly epic experience. Even though you came out on the wrong side of it, it did look like it was an exceptional game to be involved in. The shootout there between Keith Byrne and Alan O'Reilly, we wouldn't see the likes again until the All-Ireland final between Clifford and Walsh, the level of scoring that we saw there in those games. But across the course of the year, you used 31 players across your game. So I think fellas like David Bruin, Donald Rain, Mark Diffley started all 12. So they're your linchpins. And then you even had lads like Jordan Reynolds, who shone in the Tailteann Cup. He only got 2 games off the bench. So I presume that there's some players there that you use this year that you'd like to see a bit more of over the coming years. And then, you know, you had your players there that were involved the entire way through as well. So what was the experience like? I'm sorry, you had 26 scorers across the year as well. And Keith Byrne, 365. Ryan O'Rourke, 619. Dara Rooney, Jack Heslin, Donald Rinn. They're all racking up decent scores here across the year. How would you sum up the numbers when you look back on the year that you had?
Well, we hadn't won a game in 2 years, so we had, there was 2 seasons there where we didn't win a game. It was a really unusual place to come into. So we had Cavan very first game, which we probably didn't go after that game enough when you look back. But it was about to make sure that you're competitive going down the stretch. Could you be close enough to it? We probably could have pushed on a tiny bit more there if we were a bit more adventurous. But then the week after, then we went down to Tip. We had a great win. Great win against Tip. We end up losing to London, and then we would do 3 back to back. And in that period of 3 back to back, that was the most probably satisfying time of the year, because again, we hadn't won back to back then since 19. So it was huge to get. I think we did was a Waterford, Carlow, Wexford one after another, which was huge confidence builder for the team. But the key thing for it, lads, is it was Tipperary and Cavan were in Division 4, and before we started out, everyone would have said Tip, Cavan were good.
Yeah.
Like Tip went, lost the game against us, drew against Waterford, and won 5 on the bounce. So like, that was huge. Like only a team with that experience. They just won 5 on the bounce, straight out the gap. They got to 11 points. I think the aim for us at the start of the year was to get to 10, and we ended up getting to 11. So it was a really kind of skewed league because of COVID and the way it kind of fell anyway. So that was brilliant. But to get players playing consistently over that course, to get the likes of Keith Byrne scoring 8-9 points, to get Ryan O'Rourke back, who hadn't played since 19, Jack Heslin, who hadn't played since 19, this was just huge for us as a group. Now, we're trying to push on now for year 2 and year 3, and that was the aim from the start. But to get such a positive year in year 1 was probably a bonus more than anything. But what surprised me, Tommy, with it was the level of footballer that's in there considering that it's such a small pick. So if you look at a guy like Pierce Dolan in the middle of the field, exceptional player, you look at the quality that Shane Moran produced, and then you have the likes of Ryan, Keith, Donald Casey, you know, Donald Rin Dipper from college days, I think. Them guys around the place, Paddy Maguire, who's played 100, nearly 100 times, Emlyn Mulligan, all these guys, the quality is actually higher than I thought. So moving into year two, I think the key thing is that the lads could show how good the quality is. And the only way they can do that is by fit enough come January so that they can kind of just produce that right throughout the course of the league and championship.
Was that the first thing you had to sort? Like, was it fitness-wise was kind of the massive difference, or was it kind of like the whole lot, sports science scene, nutrition scene? Was fitness the main thing that was kind of just off a bit?
I think we said it, Paddy, and you've said it throughout the course of the pod this year. It's them years. So you start off in year one, you go to year two, and then it's the strength in year two, year three.
Your training age.
Where you really find it, you know? And absolutely, James. Even when Sligo ran out against us in the and Tony McEntee and Joe Kane have done good work with Sligo in terms of their physical fitness. They have a guy there called Sean Boyle that they hired as an S&C coach in Sligo. And you could see the physical shape difference of the Sligo boys compared to the Leitrim boys. Even when they ran out onto the pitch, you were like it was kind of take. But like the boys are working away and out right throughout the course of the summer, and hopefully into 2023, that them changes will come less significant, really.
I know you weren't involved, and we didn't have the Tatton Cup beforehand, so it's hard to even compare to when a season would end a little earlier after a league campaign for Leitrim. It typically would have gone championship defeat in Connacht, and then maybe knocked out in a qualifier after maybe a game or two. How much of a bounce did you get from the Tatton Cup and that experience of winning a championship game in Carrick and Shannon against Antrim, and then going down to the wire against Sligo? I know you lose on penalties, but how much did you gain from those two games after the Connacht campaign?
Yeah, well, firstly, to start, we went to London without Keith. You're on about that dead rubber game. That was the biggest disaster of all time, because it was dead rubber. Yeah. And Sean Carabine, who's, you had him on your team last week, I think, did you? You're close enough to it. And Keith
Byrne
both got sent off in the game for nothing incidences. Like, it was the weirdest thing ever. We couldn't get him off because we hadn't good enough video evidence to get him off. So
is that the reason you couldn't get him off?
Yeah, so we had to go to London without Keith, and to win over there without Keith was brilliant. I think Ryan got 2-2 to win us the game. Donald Rin played really well at full forward to score 1-1 or 1-2 as well. Then we went up to Galway and we played against Galway, and for 20 minutes, I know this sounds insignificant to everyone, but for 20 minutes, not playing 14, 15 men behind the ball, we were actually really competitive. Now, then when the Jets started going and, his name escapes me.
McDade
took off.
And a few big day that day.
Yeah, a few of the boys took off.
A few big days now,
But that was his first one, Paddy. It's funny that can kick you off. Like, that was his first real big day. He kicked four against us, three bombs in the first half, like scores of the level he kicked against Armagh. And all of a sudden he was away. You know, but we stuck with them for 20, 25 minutes, and all the lads could come out after the game and say, okay, right, we see a bit of a we're getting a tiny bit closer. Yeah, base. Now, second half ran away from us. It ended up being a 20-point defeat, but all of a sudden, it was 9-6, I think, at halftime, or 9-6 coming into the 35th minute. It was a really competitive game, so it was kind of exciting in a small way then. Then we went to play at Antrim. Boys played really well. You mentioned the likes of Jordan Reynolds. Hadn't played for Leitrim in years, had never won a game at underage level or at senior level for Leitrim, comes on that day and just absolutely was outstanding, kicks a point straight away, wins kickouts, does the same against Sligo, scores 1-1 when he comes on. So it was just a great experience for them guys to play in front of 5,000-6,000 people, and it was amazing. Fellas coming onto the pitch, we're on about the privilege of being a Division 1 team. So when you're with a Division 1 team, you get sent gloves. I don't know when the last time any of the three of us lugs bought gloves, do you know? I'm still using Murphy's gloves out of the back of the van.
I'm an ambassador, are you?
Yeah, and then I got about 3 years ago. I don't know where they are, right? And
I thought you'd be wearing them here. You're advertising.
Hey, but we had... But the boys were giving away the gloves to the kids after the game. And I was like, lads, you have to pay for them gloves. I said, like, you know, we were... But, like, that was it. The kids were coming onto the pitch. It made a huge difference to our players to see that they were gaining energy within the team, and the Talta Cup allowed that to happen.
Isn't that, like, we were on the outside looking in, and we spoke about this last year when the Talta Cup was announced. There was an obvious need for some sort of second-tier competition. And the three of us feel, from watching the games, being in Croke Park for the semi-finals and finals, that it was a success. It probably wasn't perfect in terms of the way they did the initial draw, the North and South team. But for you being in it, Andy, and for your players, was it? It was a success for you guys, like say those couple of games. It'll be probably tweaked next year to be a bit more, even better than what it was this year. But for you being in that for the first time, and for the Leitrim players, was it a success? Was it enjoyable having that there?
Paddy, it was huge. So it was a success on a playing front straight away in terms of using players, boys getting championship games against teams that are of a similar or higher level. Like, in Antrim played Division 3, we played in 4. So that was a huge success anyway, okay? Yeah. But in terms of getting momentum behind a team, like, all of a sudden, there was 4,000 people. Like, I remember saying to the boys before the Antrim game, how many people would be here? I thought they'd say 500 or 600, and they'd go, oh no, there'll be 2,500 people at this game. And I was kind of like, to go, Andy, there's nothing else in Leitrim bar Gaelic football. It's mad. So I said, I thought they were high, but there was 4,000 people at the Antrim game. And then the week after against Sligo, there was 5,000 people at the game. Now, you 5,000 people in Pádraig Sean, Paddy, it's like the penalties happened and all the kids were down at the scoreboard end, and you could see the refs saying no, and you could just see the kids scattering, banging, it was just a brilliant atmosphere. And to see the players get the lift off that, to hear Keith Byrne talking after the game and saying, "Joe, for us to be inspiring the next young players, Joe, everyone needs a target. What are you playing the game for? And if it's to bring young guys along with you." Isn't that amazing, you know?
Yeah.
I ask something just
on? Yeah, go for it, yeah.
We are massive fans of the penalty shootout.
Yes.
On this pod. And we've seen, obviously, Clare and Limerick was the first one, yourselves and Sligo, and then obviously probably one of the most iconic moments of the season, seeing it in Croker between Galway and Armagh. For you being in it, your team being in it, and unfortunately losing that day, how do you feel about penalties? It's easy for us because we're not in it and we love the drama of it.
I don't think I've ever heard a manager say they like it.
But
Andy's 0 for 2. Andy's 0 for 2 as well.
After the better
last two of them,
he came out and said, even after winning, it shouldn't be in. But as a neutral watching it, it's incredible. But Andy, come on. What was it like?
No, James, I'm going to book the trend. I like it. I've been saying for years, that it has to be an entertainment game. It genuinely has to be. And yes, we lost, and they must have been listening to you because every one of our boys opened their body. And we Devenny just read every one of them, you know. And we ended up scoring 2, missing 2. But it was, for a coach, the pressure's off you once it goes to penalties. You have no control over it, absolutely none. The boys say who wants to take them, away they go. But I think from an entertainment point of view, I think it's the way it has to go, lads. I know it's not, people are saying it's not GA, it's not this, but it's a skill of the game. You go in and you take them. If you win the game, away you go. If you don't win it, that's life. So I'm in favor of definitely some form of shootout. If they brought it to a 45 or a 35, it wouldn't bother me. Just as form, as long as it's done on the day and away you go.
Were you like Jack Charlton in Italian 90? You couldn't watch. Were you looking away, or were you? What were you like on the sideline?
No,
I was nervous watching, and I wasn't involved.
I was more nervous watching the Galway Armagh ones, which you believe. It's when it's your own team, you're just hoping for the best of the boys. And Emlyn ended up missing the penalty. Who was one of the greatest players that ever played for Leitrim. He's played over 100 times, and
a soccer man as well.
And to get to 100 caps for Leitrim is such an achievement. That's because if you're only playing 5 or 6 games a year, or maybe 8 games a year, it's so much harder for that to happen. So for him to get up to 100 was huge. But he missed the penalty, and you just feel for him in that moment. But in terms of the whole kind of penalty atmosphere and thing, I think it's a success, to be honest.
Yeah. So that was the 8th of June. And a couple of weeks later, on the 27th of June, James Horan steps down as Mayo manager. 48 hours later, the news emerges that Andy Moran has agreed to stay on with Leitrim for another 2 years.
Man, Andy.
Was it a coincidence, Andy, that it happened that quickly? Or like, was it in the works before that? What's going on there? Like, because let's not beat around the bush. The second the Mayo job comes up, you're a former player. You're in intercounty management already. Your name was floated very early in that process. Now, the Mayo process that we've seen is still rolling on. They still haven't engaged in interviews.
There's they ring a Mayall last week. Like,
oh,
good luck. I'm doing the football pod. Get away from me.
Bye, Paddy Andrews.
Yeah, see, that's the sponsorship, Paddy. You're getting paid more now, sir. Oh, don't know who had a price, didn't he? He had a price.
Yeah, he was out the gap. Yeah, I said I'd send him on Jimmy's number. Did I ring you yet, James? No.
Another zero I needed.
But, the Mayo, no, the Mayo job.
So Tommy, like signing up for whatever job was coming up last year, James was in his fourth year. It was a 4-year term.
Yes.
Like, I knew that it was a possibility that this could happen. Like, I went to, bar the semi-final between Kerry and Dublin, what a game to miss. I think I went to Crow Park every other day that was on that week, and including the Kildare Mayo game and the Roscommon Clare game the day that was on. And I came out of the Roscommon or the Mayo Kildare game, even though Mayo ended up winning that, and myself and Jenny, I had to give Jenny a mention, but myself and Jenny were on the way down the road, and I think it was fairly evident that it was going to end. If I'm being brutally honest. So we had a 5-minute conversation coming down the road. She goes, "If it comes up, what are you going to do?" I said, "Not a thing." I said, "I'm staying where I am." So the decision was made well before James had done it. Then all of a sudden, James leaves and the ego kind of hits you and you're being mentioned and all this. And I said, "I need to get myself out of here." So we between myself and the county board, we just released a statement, and it just kind of worked out really, really well, really well at the time. But it was a race that I entered that I didn't want to be in. So it was just getting yourself out as quick as you could, you know?
Like, so before we get into what's going on in Mayo, like, that's a massive statement to the Leitrim players as well. Do you know, in terms of what you're trying to do, like, you're going into that dressing room and you're trying to bring them on a journey, and they're getting that couple of weeks. Do you know, there's a long 6-7 months now until you're back playing intercounty football competitively again. That's a great carrot to have over the next few months.
But you're there and you're trying to. I went in and James pointed out was the fitness, was the physical conditioning, was that a huge point right at the start? It was, and you're telling guys this is going to be an 18-month, 2-year, maybe 3-year journey, and then the first time another job comes up, if you jump ship, like what do you stand for? So listen, I kind of bought into it really, lads. I can't. I think I talked to you, Tommy, throughout the year. Loved the job, I mean, literally, the people at Leitrim have been so good to me. We've a good board. The players have been so receptive. Like, I was thinking, I have a really good job here that I really love. You know, where will it be going? You know, and that's, I think that's what coaching is about, really, more so than yes, the draw of managing your own county is always going to be there. But listen, you got to be ready for that when you go for it. And I've got a huge opportunity here with Leitrim, and I was just happy to stay with it.
What's you just said the word, sorry, Tommy. You just mentioned the word coaching there, Andy, right? Like, when you went into Leitrim, did you kind of say, right, I'm going to save my voice here and be the kind of manager? Or was it if I get stuck in down the coaching at the very bottom? Like, how did you kind of say, I'm going to go at this? Because I obviously...
Rory Gallagher job, tackling lads in the warm-up. That's hands, literally hands on. Yeah.
James, great question. I heard you saying it about Paddy Talley last week, and you were asking the difference between the management. I'm a coach. Like, straight up, I'm on the field, I'm coaching. I was lucky enough, Mike Solon, who's now going for the Mayo job, was with me last year. We'd nearly split it. He'd do the kind of logistical side of that, dealing with the county board, and I'd be on the field kind of coaching right from the outset. I have two really good lads with me too, Barry McGuiney and James Clancy, who'd be into coaching as well. So they'd be on the field, try to get everything out of it. We got a top class S&C coach, Dahi McCabe from Dublin. He came down and he did a tiny bit with you, Paddy.
Oh, yeah.
Top class. So I'm the coach, but then I've really good people to help me as well along the way. But I'd be on the field shouting and roaring and doing the bits and pieces like that, James. Yeah.
Is that a big balance to find? And we had this conversation with Paddy Taggy last week, where backroom teams are probably more front and center now. They're not in the background. anymore. People are going, there's 10 or there's 15 or there's 20 guys there. Who's doing what? How does, you're trying to manage that as well as 35 or 40 players. And as a manager, and particularly you going in with your first kind of stint at intercounty level, that can be really daunting. You can end up spending all your time on the wrong bloody stuff. And like I say, I would always said of you and that conversation we would have had, your biggest asset in terms of going in there is coaching and being on the pitch with the lads and bringing them through. And that, like I say, it's very important to have the right people around you from the get-go. That you can, like I say, for Mike's own, you can kind of say, the county board stuff, will you deal with that this week? I want to be on. We have a game on Saturday. I need to get guys ready. And I'd say, would you say it's a pitfall for newer coaches going in, trying to find their feet in that regard?
Oh, Paddy, I've never seen anything like it. To have to learn on the job. Like, I swear to God, like, and I run my own business here. I do whatever I do.
What's the business called?
Here we
go. No, oh, sorry, the movement to your yeah. One of the best gyms in the West.
A fine setup.
A great establishment. But the truth about it, I've never seen anything that you just learn. Do you know that you were on about it there last week about the quickness of the 11 games in 17 weeks with Paddy Talley? Like, that's... when you play a league game on the Sunday, so we play all our league games on a Sunday, and because it's Division 4, so you play on a Sunday and then you play the following Sunday. Between that Sunday and the Wednesday before you train, lads, like, you don't sleep. Like, you literally, it's like, so you have to watch the video that you just played yourself, like, go through that. What do I need to pick out of this? Where do I need to go with it? You have to watch the video on the next opposition or a few videos. You're ringing the stats guy saying, can you clip all the kick out? Do you know what I'm saying? You're trying to get all this done. Yeah. And in year one, where like I got the job maybe September, October, Joe, you're kind of just kind of feeling out, trying to get players playing for you. You're not thinking about the opposition you're going to play in. Yeah. You have none of this pre-prepared. Them weeks, lads, were just...
You're probably dealing with players as well. You're probably talking to lads during the week.
Yeah, of course. And the learning curve in that, lads, is just... It is incredible. And it was brilliant. It's brilliant now when you look back and you say, jeez, I learned more there.
It's awful hard, Andy. Sure, you don't miss the pod, like.
But sure, I was carrying you there for a couple of months. Like,
you're back. You're absolutely shattered.
Like. Yeah, but it was brilliant. Like, and you look back at it now and it's you can prepare now for year two in terms of looking at teams already, and you can do all that, which is just it's huge going through and going forward. But like, enjoyed it, but it was incredibly tough throughout the course of the National League.
There's still, similar to last year, there's a lot of movement going on in intercounty circles. There's still 7 or 8 positions to be filled. Donegal, Mayo, Monaghan, Roscommon, Offaly have appointed Liam Kearns earlier in the week. Longford, Wexford, Wicklow in terms of football. Conor Laverty has come in to Down. He's got that job now. Marty Clark has come on board with him and got a strong backroom to there. Andy McEntee was appointed in Antrim.
Is Marty Clark gone in, did you say?
With Marty Laverty. Clark's gone in with Laverty, yeah. They've been working together for the last couple of years at 20s and
very good. Underage.
John Cleary replaced Keith Ricken in Cork after Ricken had to step away, and Conor Rourke has been appointed in Meath. Can I just ask you, Andy, I'm hoping you lift the veil here. Has the intercounty manager's WhatsApp group just been hopping? Have lads just been leaving and entering? Like, what's that process been like?
Yeah, there's no.
Or has it not been reset yet? Who's the admin? Who's the admin in the group?
I think Colin O'Rourke, I think, is he?
Everyone's gone on mute since O'Rourke got the job.
Voice notes from O'Rourke.
But I think, it's a mad time. And like, what's happening now is that you have all these national newspapers who have nothing to write about.
Yeah.
And it's gone crazy. And you see the Mayo and what's happened. The Mayo process is actually fine. There's nothing wrong with the Mayo process. It's right. The length of time that has actually taken to get it. So it's just
gone on too long.
It's gone on too long. And when you leave that vacuum, now all of a sudden you have really good people who've represented Mayo at all levels being absolutely torn asunder on social media. And you're like, well, you just get it done, you know. But
it's gone into week 7 now.
It's gone into week 7 and it'll be well into the second month. And it's just, you just like what I'm hearing, you're not about these WhatsApp groups. There's no WhatsApp group. But what you're hearing in the background is that an awful lot of counties and an awful lot of background teams are waiting to see what happens with that Mayo job, to see can they gobble up a few of some of the 3 teams that don't get the job, you know.
Because there's some very strong candidates here.
Last week, literally the week after the All-Ireland final, it was WhatsApp groups. There was rumours in Dublin. There was rumours with Monaghan. and was going, what's true here? And it's exactly that. There's nothing else to write about until the club seasons have started, the first round of a lot of club championships. But until that kind of gets to maybe semi-finals and finals in the respective counties, there is a window there of maybe 4 or 5 weeks where the inter-county season's finished. The club season hasn't really kicked in. So if you're sitting there as a GAA journalist, like, we've seen some of the stories, and we're getting the WhatsApps in the back and going, this is complete and utter
Paddy bullshit. Hates WhatsApp. Paddy hates WhatsApp rumors.
Well, like, it's so, like...
You're right.
It's nonsense, like. There's no credibility behind it. And then people hound and go, is this legit? I'm like, no. It's like, there's, like, me getting offered a Mayo job. Like, that was... No, that's not true.
they were so impressed with you in the TF.
Yeah. Exactly. Yeah. But I think you're right. It'll still go on for... Because... Okay, so two jobs are filled this week in Down and Offaly. There's still, like you say, there's still some big counties, like not just Mayo, where this is going to go on for the next couple of weeks.
Yeah.
The
club championships will heat up. But Andy, we were even saying last night, like, the only thing we're really watching at the minute is the bloody Chicago championships, or the Boston championship is on this Sunday, you know? And like, people are just craving football at the minute. So once you start getting a bit of club action on TV, I think it'll change.
But what do we think, lads? Sorry, just on the split season. You're obviously a coach in it now, Andy. There was a crying out that give the club guys their own window. I liked the nature of the season, where it's games. And Jimmy, we touched on it a couple of times throughout the last couple of months, where you don't play a championship match and you're waiting 4 weeks for the next one. I like the championship's finished in July, and I get that, but I preferred it. But it seems to be getting a lot of negativity now at the minute, that they're going, look, beautiful weather, it's August, and there's no bloody big games in Croke Park.
But I can add to that, right? As a club player, no. We're going into a block of probably, hopefully, 8 to 10 weeks of just matches with the club that, like, the club players don't get enough of that. Do you know, the weather's going to be unreal. You have a chance to get together, play your club season together, and it's brilliant for the clubs. And So I know that it is a downside that we're not watching inter-county matches, but as the main people involved in football are club players. So, like, it's important that they get a good run at it as well. And it's brilliant to be involved with your club over a sustained period. So I have that angle in terms of, fair enough, we're missing the big games in Croke Park, but like, there's still brilliant football going on.
Yeah, no, I love that, James, because it's like what I was saying about Leitrim. You're a bit ignorant to it when you're not actually part of it. You're back now playing club. You can actually see, okay, lads, we're going to get a block of eight. You can see that, which is a great viewpoint of it. Where are you back playing, Paddy?
No.
Okay, so I think I'm dusting off the boots this weekend. But anyway, I haven't
played. Cobwebs on them, is there?
Is that breaking? Is that breaking? On Monday? Is this breaking news?
Yeah, I actually don't know, to be honest with you. We'll see. But I haven't kicked the ball.
Just when you take her out,
you haven't kicked the ball. You've been sending me photos of you with a bag of O'Neill's out in the pitch in the early evenings.
And that was after watching Clifford and Welsh. We have to talk about that yet. But the split season, I think it has to play out its course. This season has to play, and then we have to make a justification. But like everything in the world now, like, it's, you're either for something or you're against it. Like, can we not just get the best of both? Like Donal Oak had a statement I thought was one of the best bits of TV I've seen all year. Like, you know, and like, people were right now, I went into the comments on Twitter, note to oneself, but it was, oh, you're only missing out for a month on money and all this. And I'm like, he's on a contract, it doesn't matter shit to him if he's finished in July or August. Like, these people really do care about the game. And I think if Michael Murphy, for instance, is out of the championship in May and he doesn't play on the telly for the whole year from May until next February, that is a loss to the GAA. Like, no matter how much you dress it up, that is a competitive loss if you're not seeing your best players playing. But then the plus side of it is exactly what James just said. The club players know when they're playing and the way they go. The other side of it, though, is TJ Reid came out last week with a really good statement as well. And he said he doesn't like it. So Lee Chin came out and said he loves it. Yeah. And then TJ Reid comes out and says, but okay, it's all right for the club players.
That's interesting. Because he's obviously a successful club as well. Like, unbelievably successful club. Well, I didn't say that. What? He wanted to play as normal first week of September, All Ireland hurling final.
Yeah, he goes, I could be misquoting him, but what he said, people are saying this really helps the club player, but he said, you're telling me that the club player isn't going to have any significant game from January to the 1st of August or to the 1st of September for the whole year. He goes, how are you going to hold them players? He said, And I think that's what he said. Could be misquoting him, so TJ, if I am, I apologise. But he goes 1 to 15, he said, you'll probably hold. But he said, how are you going to hold that player from 16 to 30? He said, how are you going to hold him right through? And you have seen it in different counties around the place where the likes of Mayo get knocked out against Kerry in the quarterfinal. Like, we had an awful lot of players gone. Like, there was a club quarterfinal, league quarterfinal pull last week because one team couldn't significant or couldn't play a game. I think in Longford, there was an intermediate or there was a senior championship game pull last week because they couldn't fulfill the team. They didn't have a team played. Because all these young fellas now can see there is a period here where I can scatter and I can go. And if you give that, if there's not a lot of games between May, June and July, I do think that is a risk to it. But what's have to wait till it plays out and see what's right and what's wrong, you know?
Like, club championships in Mayo this year didn't start till September, right?
There's no change.
So, like, a lot of counties did that where they waited. They didn't bother actually changing that with split season. It's the first year of it. I absolutely don't think it's perfect.
No.
But I think that they can work towards, you know, making this a bit better and build on the stuff that we learned this year. And like, as you said, like the reaction to some of the comments from O'Donoghue and others was absolutely ridiculous. It was, you know, it's so adamant. Everyone's not that black and white. There's a gray area here somewhere that, as James says, the club player needs to sustain the amount of time where he knows he's going to get games, and the intercounty season could be a little
But Paddy and James, have you noticed over the course of the years too, that there's supporters now that just support Kerry, Dublin and Mayo. They don't have a club.
100%. Yeah,
100%. So that...
I think that was always the way, though. I don't think that's just a recent thing.
I think
is that
so,
in every county, though?
But I think when the county stuff stopped, Tommy or Paddy, and there wasn't as much on telly, I think that guys would go down to the club and maybe be involved. But there is, in Mayo particularly, there's Mayo supporters who are aligned to no club.
Wow. You know? I didn't really cop that.
And I think this is a new thing that has never really happened before. I don't think it's happened as much, Paddy, in my time. I think that could be a huge thing, and it just leaves a vacuum there, and I think it leaves a dangerous vacuum that some fellas who they want to might bring a few retired players, but they might set up a little thing in Dubai over the course of two weekends or something like that where they could pay players. I do think
Andy, you're on.
Love it.
I have to get over for that.
Yeah. Just off them boots, Jimmy. Just off them boots.
I'll do it for Dubai, I tell you what.
I do think it does leave a vacuum. You see what happened in Chicago. Twitter blew up about the Chicago Club Championship.
But it was class.
What would be the downside of that? Tried to win the Chicago championship
and they couldn't play it, like,
you can only have, it doesn't matter, lads, we win the Chicago championship. Yeah,
you can only have three county players on the pitch, so there were something on and off for each other.
James Horn was going over managing.
James, what were you saying there? You wanted to get in on Dubai?
I was going to say that it would be good to get, like, we're so set in National League, Championship, County League, Club Championship, like, to throw in a spanner in the works and have this random thing, like, it would be unreal. We need to do more of that. As Andy says, the entertainment factor, like, we need to do something off the cuff just to, like, that football season at the start was slow moving. Mm. You know, like, as invested as we all were, some of the Division One games were very slow. They were a bit drab, a bit boring. Like, we need to fire it up with a bit of excitement and just trying something new. I'm all for it anyway. Dubai, next up.
Speaking of entertainment, I'm on my holidays, but I think you boys are all going to work. So we've a couple of quick fire questions to get through here before we finish off. Andy Moran, can you talk to us about, like, we all love football in this pod, but I think there's a chance that Andy Moran might love football more than anyone else in the world. How much did you love the Clifford Walsh show? Just taking that in isolation, the points that we saw being kicked from play, the moments, the mark, the shimmies. Like, how much did you love that in Croke Park? Did you appreciate it?
Yeah, like, we've seen Shane playing for years. And me and Paddy, I suppose, against Monaghan last year and stuff like that. And we were just waiting for this fella to explode onto the scene, and I was delighted for him, if I'm being honest. I know he lost All Ireland. It's not going to make up for him losing the All Ireland, and for a person that's been there, nothing makes up for that. But for him to put on that show in Croker, American, like Tom O'Sullivan, was just like that's amazing. I'm a big fan, massive fan, and I love the way Paddy Talley said he didn't realise how good of a footballer Tom O'Sullivan. I tell you all of my own, how good of a footballer Tom O'Sullivan is. He's just sensational. But he's like, to do that against Thomas Hulling was unreal. I'm a huge, like, outrageous fan of Clifford. Like, I just, I've loved him since, like, not the, the minor stuff. The first day I seen him playing senior was in McHale Park in, you know, McHale Park, winter.
Yeah,
I do. And everyone was like, ah, this book isn't this good. I was like, this fella's doing stuff I've actually never seen before in a football field. I remember he used to do this shimmy where, or this move where he used to lean into the corner back and come out 3 yards. You know the one, James, where he just shows out in front quickly? So I went to training the week after that, you know, and I said, I lean in here. I forgot that I was 5'9" and probably about 14 stone, and I can't move.
Big arse there to get
But he was just moving shit in, out, and away you go. And I think he did this year. James, you probably know more about this than anyone. I don't think he... I would argue there's a point that he didn't train from the Mayo game to the All-Ireland final as a group. Because he never looked... He never looked at full fitness. And he does what he does. It's just... I just think it's incredible. Like, there was a moment, the second mark, I got I was eating the prawn sandwiches the day the All-Ireland final was down beside Michael D, and Ross Munley was sitting right behind me, and we were just having a few chats during the game, and the second ball goes in for the second mark, and Munley hits me, the ball is mid-air, he said he couldn't, you know, and it was just the air of excitement with this, you know, kind of godlike monster figure. Like, I remember even Kerry just produced him. I remember the first day, James, I seen you playing. You came on against Cork. I think you came on and you kicked one. I think it was in Killarney with your right leg across the bar with inside your foot, and you shaped your foot in a weird sort of way. And I was just like, how did you do this? And my brother-in-law, he wasn't at the time, but a good buddy of mine, Stephen Drake, just texted me. He goes, how do these fuckers keep producing forwards? You know, and this was a new kick. And then you just see... I went down playing minor against Kerry. Didn't know who the Gooch was when I went down. And all you kept hearing was, give it to Gooch, give it to Gooch. I was like, who is this Gooch fella? Like, you know, but they just keep producing this nine of forward. And to me, no offence to the Gooches and the Donoghues and the Morris Fitzes, this guy is just, he's off the charts. I'd love to just get James for 30 seconds there. Just, you know, I know you don't like blowing up a fella, but it's hard not to blow him up, isn't it?
It is, but you know, he's so grounded, and the fact that he was such a, he was almost a superstar at minor. Like, he came through the same Hogan Cups minor. It was like, when's this fella going to hit the road running? And he did. Like, he didn't have any settling in period. He just came in, did his thing quietly, trained hard, physically turned into an absolute specimen. So I always say about Clifford, he's 6'2", but he plays 5'10". Like, he can do all the small stuff, in and out of fellas, dancing. Like, that point he got against Dublin when he went around Fitzsimons and back out onto the right and swung it up.
Four lads he went around.
There's no, yeah, but there's no fella 6'2" that can move like that, you know, the swing of the hips and to bring it around. So I couldn't speak highly enough of him. And you're right, there's more to come from him. And
did you like the way Tally nailed him down last week?
Yeah.
He can't tackle him. Tally's onto something. Clifford does that in games. And is it, James, do you get grilled that hard for your tackle counts? Is he just saying, sure, I couldn't tackle, I got a yellow card?
No, you can't get away with
that. No, he would definitely. He'd definitely be under pressure in terms of getting his tackle count up 100%. But like, when you're carrying a knock or something like that, or carrying I think it was a calf he had or an ankle, and next thing you get stuck in something you don't want to be stuck in. In that final, me and Paddy were watching it, right? Shane Walsh hit four tackles on the spin down in the corner of the Hogan, right? And we were like, what an animal, work rate. What a brilliant, brilliant player for his team. Did not touch the ball for the rest of the game.
Rest of the game.
Like, so some fellas, you just have to say, right, stay out of it a bit.
Yeah, Clifford runs back in the first half against Sean Kelly. And it looks like he pulls up. I keep an eye on him. I don't think he tackled again after. Oh, no, he did. He butchered Kelly with an old shot to the jaw. But after that, he didn't tackle again, because it was like, I actually never thought he looked fully at his peak, you know, during the year. And I just find him the most incredible. I remember he scored the goal against Monaghan and Clonus. Remember in that?
Yeah, in 18.
Yeah, right.
James played the ball. Donny flicks it.
And I was just like, didn't even score that, you know. And you know what I think is a real special forward? I'm not, Paddy, there's no disrespect to either myself or yourself. I don't think we had this in the locker. But you know the way Shane Walsh scores a goal against Roscommon, where he comes back out, like, he's literally facing the other way.
Yeah.
Like, I think that's the most incredible skill of all. Yeah. And like the point that James is talking about where Clifford takes on Fitzsimons and goes, he's running, he's going towards his own goal and he kicks it. I'm like, I dislocate my hip if I try to do it.
You know, you're right, isn't it? Like we all, and Andy, you're the coach, you go in and you'd be like, everyone's the same. All 15 is, and there's guys to come on, the tackles to do all of this stuff. But you need to understand there are certain guys who are just a little bit different. And if it means that the other five forwards have to do work a little bit harder, the old Cristiano Ronaldo job, well, then you just do it because you're going
to get... You have to be delivering. Say Clifford, you're
going to get the dividends.
Has to put the scores on the board, yeah.
This guy is going to do something that you other five Muppets can't do. Yeah. And that's, as a player, you need to understand that as well. And that's being a good teammate and kind of saying, David, you get your breath there. I'll run back 60 yards and do the donkey work because you still have to do that work for the team. But you know, when Clifford gets the ball the next time, he's going to do another outrageous thing. And for us, you're saying, Jimmy, he's a superstar. Like, we would have known about him. Our team was being successful and then you kind of see this guy winning the Holden Cups and minors and stuff. And the first time we came across him was in a league game. I think it was February or March in Croker in 18. It was the first time we played against him. And we were chatting about him. We'd won three All-Irelands in a row at this time. we were a confident team. And we're going, like, this fella's coming in. This is the first go at him. Let's see what he's like. And he scored. We ended up winning the game. But I think Kerry were winning at half-time. And he ended up on Keane O'Sullivan, I think. And he kicks 3 points into the canal. And it was a Sunday. It was an odd because it was a Sunday game against Kerry. And normally they're always Saturday nights. But he was... We were watching him that day on the pitch. And we kind of got to grips with a bit in the second half, kind of inexperience and stuff like that. But straight away, his first game against us, he was doing things where you're like, shit, these guys are going to be a handful for the next 10 years. I was delighted because I was on the way out anyway. I knew I wouldn't have to worry about him too much longer. But right from the get-go, he's been a
superstar. Your cornerback days were over as well.
We're long over. Jesus.
You could enjoy him.
I could enjoy it, but you know, I think that's one of the most impressive things with him, that he's come in with, I know you say there's no pressure on him. There is massive pressure because the whole country knew about him.
Paddy, the pressure going into him in that final was, I don't care.
Yeah.
Insane. And for him to catch the first ball and just...
He was spectacular.
Yeah, nonchalantly just peg it. Like, his first point, like, I call him Eric from play. There's no way I'm giving Americans a free. So he gets five from play, I think. No. But his first one from open play... was where he turns out and he just kicks it over from 35 yards and it makes it look like it's a simple...
Isn't that... It's just so easy. Like, just I'll clip it over. Like, just a little... Like,
how do you even do it? Like, you know, like, Jesus, I'd have to... Oh, yeah. The 2 feet would be off the ground. I'd be whipping it, like, you know?
What I'd love to see is... Do you remember when yourself and Killian and they were inside from Mayo, right? And you had this unbelievable relationship where you'd almost be screening for each other and every run you make, you were both involved in that.
Mm.
Like... If Clifford could get that relationship with someone where they were selflessly helping him out to get more ball and vice versa, I think it would take him even to another level. You know, like sometimes he has to work very hard, wrestling his man off out to the corner. Like that relationship that you and Killian had, it was almost unstoppable. Once the ball was kicked, you were winning it. Like,
no, and I think Paddy and particularly Darren Moynihan when he's playing does it on a defensive point of view. But I know exactly what you mean. You're on about that screener inside where it'd be magic stuff. It's just, I just think we're privileged. The whole debate of Walsh or Clifford, like. It's like, I remember I used to be, I'm still a massive Ronaldo fan, right? Never supported United or nothing. I don't know why. But it used to be Ronaldo or Messi. But when I got a bit older, I could just think, just enjoy the two of them. You know, just enjoy the... What are we arguing about here? We're just after seeing the most beautiful 48 to 50 minutes of football from two guys. It was just, it was incredible. And yeah, if he got that, James, I think it would just be, like, I think it'd be magic stuff, you know?
Yeah. There we go. I think that's a perfect place to leave this week's episode of the Football Pod. Andy Moran, it was lovely having you back.
Thanks, lads. Keep up the great work. Keep up the great work yourself. Keep Tommy in check now. When he's getting these big money transfers, you need to be pulling him up on it. That's the only thing I'm saying.
Move once more before his career finishes as well.
If there's another zero.
Checking out Kerry the weekend.
You short out the void and Andy, really.
Legion will take you.
He said he'd only go to Cracklow if Colm Collins stayed on. So the deal was set. You know, the deal was set.
Yeah, he's like happy. He's stuck in managerial decisions and everything now.
Lads, thanks very much.
Andy Moran, thank you so much. Paddy, James, well done this week, boys. We're going to be back next week with another episode of the Football Pod. Stay tuned. Andy Moran will talk soon. Thanks, boys.
Thanks, lads.